busy, but good.
Good evening, everyone. It is 5:30. We are going to start with our public hearing on the 2018-2019 Texas Academic Performance Report. Mr. Salsinas.
Good evening, Board President, Board of Trustees, Dr. Vidaudi. Today, we will be going over the annual report. This annual report is for the 2018-2019 school year. So what we'll see here is quite a bit of data that the Board of Trustees has already seen. Again, this is data from last year, and in some instances, data from 2 years ago because of the delay in reporting from TEA. It is a public hearing, so if we do have any questions at any point, just let me know, and we can definitely address any questions or concerns. There's a total of 385 pages within this report. Obviously, yes, we're going to go detail by detail, line by line through each report. I know we're going to hit the high points throughout the report. There are a few things legislatively we're required to hit throughout this report. But at any point, if there's something specifically that you see or that any members in the audience really want us to clarify, we're definitely willing to do that. But just so you know, we're going to be going pretty fast through a lot of this content because of the amount of content within the report. So we do have until 6 o'clock, until the beginning of the board meeting. So don't be afraid to ask questions. We're going to be living the life of looking at a lot of data right now. So what's included in this report is essentially the bulk of the report is our Texas Academic Performance Report. A lot of ISDs refer to this as TAPER. It has the district and each campus. It has our district accreditation status. It has our PEAMS financial standard report for the 17-18 school year, campus performance objectives, student performance in post-secondary institutions, report on violent or criminal incidents on campuses, and also we have a supplementary packet here with a glossary, which is about 40 or 50 pages just for the glossary. So if you see an acronym within the report that you're not quite sure where that information comes from or what that specific thing means, you can definitely look in here and it should provide some additional detail for you. So the TAPER is compiled by TEA for every district and campus. It uses our information from PEAMS and student assessment data. Beginning in 2017-2018, it's published in two different ways. It's published via a PDF. That PDF copy is what we have currently within the report. And also a more comprehensive format online through HTML. Essentially, every single time TEA releases a data point that can be included within here, it's updated in real time. So the cover page within the report gives us information regarding to our campus letter grade, special ed determination status when we met standards, 2019 Armed Services Vocational Aptitude Battery, or ASVAB, at the district level, and 2019 distinction designations if they were earned. So that one at the cover page for each of the campuses and district just kind of gives a brief summary of how we did overall, that we met standards, the letter grade, and any distinctions. The STAR performance within the report gives us all performance rates broken down for each assessment and grade level. Only students that are reflected for accountability are included in with this report. Also school progress, SSI performance, bilingual, and ESL performance, and only includes results for students included in the accountability subset. So this is really important in the sense that if you see something within this report that doesn't jive from something you saw 2-3 months ago, 4 months ago, that's because this is considered the most clean report. Most clean probably isn't the correct phrasing, but this is the report where only the specific students that are 100% sure as part of the accountability subset are in here. So you may see a variance of like 1%, 2% at the most, but for the most part, our numbers match from end of year to current year pretty consistently within our accountability subset. Also within the taper includes exam participation, attendance, graduation and dropout rates, CCMR, student demographic, staff demographic, and program information for both students and staff. So all of these are broken out at multiple levels, and we can definitely dive into specific things included within the taper here. So what we have here is specific taper summaries. There's actually a summary for each campus, each grade level within taper. But what we're gonna do is we're gonna look at the overall subject area performances for each subject area. For reading, what we can see is that we remained pretty consistent from the previous year and did see a slight increase in the master's grade level for reading. We are above both the state and the region within the academic performance for reading. So that's a positive sign, and we did see growth and improvement. For the area of writing, we did see a consistent performance in approaches grade level, a slight dip for meets grade level, and an increase for master's grade level. So we saw one area go down and the other area go up. Again, approaches, meets, and masters are just the different levels of performance on the STAR assessments. So that kind of gives you an idea more or less how that averages. So we did see a slight dip between fourth and seventh grade writing here in the meets grade level, but an increase in the master's grade level performance, which is our top end performance. In the areas of mathematics, approaches grade level remain consistent. Meets grade level increased and master's grade level increased. So we did see an increase in performance overall in the areas of math also. For science, we saw increases in approaches, meets, and master's performance. So there was improvement in all three reporting categories. So that includes fifth grade, eighth grade, and biology scores. So overall, as a district, we did improve pretty significantly in the areas of science. In social studies, there was growth in approaches and meets, and master's stayed consistent, but there was growth overall in those two reporting categories. And the overall performance, once everything was calculated together, what we saw was consistent performances in approaches and meets, and then an increase in master's performance. So overall, we got a little bit better than the previous year. Once everything was calculated out, we did see a small improvement, but it's an improvement nonetheless. And it was a very strong performance overall. For our dropout rate, we did see an improvement in our dropout rate from 0.1% to 0.0% for the 2017-2018 school year. And the annual dropout rate, which is calculated a little bit different, the first one is for 7th and 8th, and then the 9th through 12th dropout rate, we saw also a decrease in the dropout rate from 0.6 to 0.5. This data is a little older in the sense that it's from the 2017-2018 school year, because dropout rate and a lot of our graduation data methodology runs a year behind from TEA. So typically when we're evaluated on things like CCMR, graduation rates and dropout rates, it does run behind. So that's where we kind of see some of the older data that we're about to jump into. For post-secondary information here, we did see a pretty substantial increase in participation. So what we in the 16-17 school year, we essentially tested around 2 out of every 3 kids in the district. And in the 17-18 school year, it was about 4 out of every 5 kids. So there's a pretty significant increase in the participation for TSI. Not only was there an increase in the amount of kids that took the test, but there was also an increase in the performance of students there. So typically when you see a big increase in participation, usually the performance dips, but we saw that actually remained steady and actually improved over the course of the year for reading and math. The TSI results, we did see for the annual graduation that the amount of students meeting the reading criteria increase, as well as the math and overall for both subjects. So our kids are leaving us college ready within TSI. And we can see here that there were some pretty significant jumps in performance overall. Staff demographics, overall, according to the TAPER report, we have 1,327 staff members in the district. Most of that professional staff is 59.9% of our staffing category, and teachers represent 48%. So most of our staff is considered professional staff, and it's fairly aligned with the state as far as demographics and other campuses. The significant difference there would be the auxiliary staff, where we see a little over a 4% increase. The state did provide for this report libraries and counselors report, but since that data has not been available for a consistent amount of time, we haven't seen a specific percent or the state's getting like a baseline to determine whether or not we have an appropriate number. But they did start collecting data and they did report it, so we wanted to include it within the report. So for the 2018-2019 school year, the district accreditation status is accredited. So that means that our kids are able to attend institutes of higher ed, and they consider that diploma a value, and that we met the curriculum requirements for that. The annual financial report is also attached. This is a requirement of this report. You can see that the bulk of our funding does go specifically to instruction, and that's aligned with what we see. Most of these numbers are aligned pretty directly with what we see at the state level also. So this is the requirement that we publish the annual financial report here. This is straight off of the TEA website. So there's also multiple reports on the TEA website if you want to look at some specific ones, but this is just overall the general report. A requirement of the annual report is to review district and campus performance objectives. You may remember a few months ago where we took these district and campus performance objectives to the board, and in a public meeting, we spoke about each of these in detail. So I'm not going to read each performance objective. I'm just going to talk in general what each goal pertains to. Goal one, which is parents will be full partners in the education of their children. This is our parent involvement goal here, and it lists specific performance objectives in order to ensure that goal is met. Goal two, students will be encouraged and challenged to meet their full educational potential. There's a lot of specific performance objectives and strategies centered around attendance and special program goals regarding 504, special ed. A lot of our special POP performance objectives exist within this performance objective here and goal. Goal three is our graduation goal. Through enhanced dropout prevention efforts, all students will remain in school until they obtain a high school diploma. And that goal is centered around having a graduation rate above 97%. Goal four is usually our largest goal, which centers around student achievement and CTE. So that's anything curriculum related, student performance wise, where those performance objectives live. There's also a lot of CTE performance objectives that exist within this goal. Goal five is our HR recruitment and support goal. It's to find qualified and highly effective personnel to be recruited, developed, and retained via a highly qualified recruitment plan. And goal six pertains to CCMR and some accountability indicators so that our students can demonstrate exemplary performance in comparison to local, state, and national standards. Goal seven is our goal centered around a safe and secure environment. It also contains a lot of specific performance objectives centered around our DAEP and compliance areas. So a lot of these performance objectives, a lot of the performance objectives within this goal pertain to the specific safe and secure learning environment. Goal eight is our technology specific goal. Technology will be implemented and used to increase effectiveness of student learning, instructional management, staff development, and administration. So this is where we see a lot of performance objectives and strategies regarding our district replacement plan and specific areas of how that technology is utilized in the classroom. Our 2017-2018 Student Performance in Post-Secondary Institution gives us a summary from the Texas Higher Ed Coordinating Board as far as how our students are doing at the college level once they leave our campus. This data is largely incomplete and because not every college submits their data. So you'll see that there are a substantial amount of students that are either not trackable or not found throughout the data. But what it does do is it kind of gives us a snapshot of whoever is reporting how our students are performing. A lot of independent private colleges, as well as career and tech schools, do not report their data to Texas Higher Ed Coordinating Board. So we take a lot of this with a grain of salt. But what we can see is that the majority of our students that are attending four-year universities are being successful. So that, to me, is a good takeaway. Our kids are leaving prepared and ready for the next step. So we did see that was pretty consistent at both SHS and PHS. According to this report, we will get additional targeted data for SA3 beginning next year. That's when their reporting will come out. So report on violent and criminal incidents. Again, this is for the previous school year, the 2018-2019 school year. What we saw at the elementary level, that there were no incidents recording. So this is a report that is presented to the extent allowable under FERPA, which is a presentation on the specific PEAMS coding, reason codes for any violent or criminal incidents as far as PEAMS coding. At the high school level, we did have two incidents. One was a controlled substance, and the other one was a prohibited weapon. They were at Pioneer and SA3, so two total incidents. In order to have be considered a persistently violent or criminal, it has to be over 1% as the district. For those campuses, they're about 0.08%. So they would have to have around another 14 or 15 incidents before that label comes into play. So obviously we don't have that specific label here, so because we're definitely significantly under the threshold. I also have copies of the annual report here. There's also a glossary. There's lots of acronyms listed within the report, or there's some additional information here. This glossary also provides a lot of additional detail as far as where that methodology comes from, what reports are running into, and especially in the areas of student assessment, what specific tests are included in each of those data points. So the overall, there's a lot of information within the annual report, a little over 350 pages. So we're not gonna go through each of those, but I'm willing to fill any questions that you may have regarding the information in this report. No problem. This report is publicly available on the Shareland ISD website. It's also the majority of this information is from the TAPER report, which is publicly available on the TA website. So it is available.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
We move on to item three, public comments on the report. Public comments on the report. No. Okay, so this concludes our agenda for today's public hearing on the 2018-2019 Texas Academic Performance Report.